Gary, you made history today, something that has never happened in baseball, where there wasn't a fan in the stands, at least that paid to get in there. Tell us a little bit about your thoughts of how you approached the game. Any differently than a regular game?
No. You know, I didn't. You have to think about those things, I guess, and I did this morning, and I just thought, no, there's nothing to be done here. We're broadcasting a baseball game, and let's just do it the way we normally would do it while making the appropriate historical references to the game and the fact nobody's here and the reasons for it and all of that. But as far as the game itself is concerned, I just wanted to do the ball game.
Well, Gary, we heard your home run call in the press box, obviously, and that was significant.
Sorry.
Well, that's right. You interrupted me a little bit. I was right in the middle of a thought, and then you scream out, home run, or whatever you said. But the point is, that was weird for us to hear that. What do you think was the strangest thing? What will be the picture or the snapshot you remember about this game?
The fans outside the fence. I hadn't thought about that. Didn't realize they would be able to do that, would be able to get that close. And right when the game started, they were chanting, you know, let's go O's. We got a shot of them outside the ballpark. That's what I will remember about this game. That was nice. That was just a really nice touch. They couldn't get in, but they were still cheering and were still here at the ballpark. And I just thought that was special.
Gary, I don't know if you saw it, and it was probably off camera. I'm not really sure whether it was or not, and let me know whether you did see it. Chris Davis actually came off, and you know how he normally throws the ball into the stands when fans are there. Well, he did, a ceremonial one. Did you catch that when he actually did that? It was somewhere around the middle of the game.
Yes. Yeah, I saw that. We were trying to get a camera on somebody who was doing that because somebody else, it may have been Samaje, did the same thing on the other side after he came out for one of them, kind of flipped it into the seats. We knew there would be things like that that would be going on here, and you're trying to spot those. I mean, it was Caleb Joseph before the game signing a fake autograph by the seats, handing it over to nobody, waved to them, then ran out to center field, did a Cal Jr. thing, running down waving to nobody, and went out to center field and bowed. I mean, the seriousness of what's behind all of this is not forgotten, but you need to smile, and there were things like that that happened today that will be snapshots for this ball game and its place in history.
Gary, obviously you've done games in the majors for a long, long time, but you also worked in minor leagues doing baseball. Was there anything similar to this thing in the minors where, you know, you had so few people, or obviously there was none, but today inside the stands. But, you know, did you ever do a game maybe where there was only 10 people in the stands?
I honestly don't think so. I tried to think back to the smallest crowd that I could remember, and I mean, there were a couple of games where we had probably 400 or 500 people in the stands, but that was really about as few of people as I've ever announced a game before. I remember during one of the whatever it was, strike season or something was going on and Major League Baseball wasn't being played, and I was doing ESPN games, and we went to college campuses and we broadcast games from the colleges, and there were a couple of those where it was freezing cold, and I don't remember if we were in South Carolina or somewhere, but it was very cold. Nobody came out, really. And there, that was probably as close as I've ever been to being in doing a broadcast in a ballpark where you hear your own voice echoing around.
Gary, how about the Orioles, the way they're playing the last three games? In fact, scoring 6 times in 3 different innings over a 9-inning period of time over 2 games. What do you see?
Yeah. It's really amazing. Talking with Scott Coolbaugh during spring training, we talk about guys going to the plate with a thought, with an approach. And Adam Jones, I talked with him about this too in spring training. And the theory at the beginning was, look, pitchers know that this team's got a number of guys who will chase pitchers, Adam being one of them on those sliders breaking balls away. So what we got to do is get the opposing pitchers to understand we're not going to do that. Get that 1-0 count, get that 2-1 count, and then get a pitch that you can hit. That was their approach at the beginning of the season, and I think it was real, and I think it worked. I think they started getting better pitches to hit. Now what I think's happened is they've adjusted to the pitchers who now think the Orioles are going to take some first pitches, so the pitchers are inclined to adjust, throw a strike. The Orioles have adjusted ahead of them and are going after first pitches now. And I think we're going to see this play out. It plays out all season long for every ball club and every hitter. But for the Orioles, this is a thought process they've gone through, now trying to stay ahead of the pitcher's adjustment and get those best pitches to hit, whether they're going to be first pitch or whether they're going to be second or third pitch. And right now, they've got an approach, they're following it, and it's working.
Gary, let's go back to the empty stadium story for a second. What about all the foul balls? Did you mark them so you can go back there in a day or two and pick them all up?
I did not. But, you know,
but it's like an Easter egg hunt, right?
I'm not a big collector of items, but I will go down here. I'm sitting up in the booth still. I will go downstairs or over here where I saw a couple. If I can find one, I'm taking it home. And I'll have Buck or somebody autograph that thing. I don't collect much memorabilia, but I would take a foul ball in the stands here in this game and take it home, put it on my desk.
Well, you remember,
memento.
Remember your old friend, me. Remember? Buddy, old pal.
Hey, Gary, when you look at this season coming in out of spring training, actually going into spring training and then coming out, I mean, could anybody really have thought that Ubaldo Jimenez was going to pitch as well as he has? I mean, give us an idea what you see from him right now and the difference between what he's doing right now and what you saw last year.
Well, you know, we talked about this. All of us did, off camera and on the sidelines talking about the Orioles pitching staff and Ubaldo Jimenez. And, oh, my God, it's going to be such a disaster. And how long can he last? And when will they have to pull him out? And who will they put in his place? I mean, that was the talk. That was the expectation. And it wasn't unreasonable in light of the way he pitched last year. And can you really have the kind of turnaround we've seen? Can you expect that to happen? I think the answer to that is no. I give great credit, you know, to Buck and to Dave and to Dom Chidi, but most of all to him. You can tell him what he needs to do and how to correct it, but he's got to do it. And he has. I mean, and I think the biggest thing to me is I saw a guy last year who didn't want to throw a strike out of fear. I see a guy now who comes out to the mound and challenges hitters. And to me, that's the difference. And why it happened is, you know, he listened to what was being said, but he rose to the occasion. And God love him. For the sake of the Orioles and himself, I hope he does it for the rest of the year.
Well, Gary, we thank you. And, you know, it was really nice to see you part of baseball history with no fans allowed at Baltimore's Camden Yards and the Orioles' victory today, 8-2 over the Chicago White Sox. Look forward to chatting with you again in the not too distant future.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate it.
Gary Thorne, the massive voice of the Orioles.